Hey there, business owners, directors, and marketeers. In today's show, I'm speaking to Norman Siddick from CloudLead, and I'm Lucas, your host, as always. And I want to tell you just a little bit about Norman before we actually starting the show and introducing himself. So he's the founder and CEO of CloudLead, and is very active in the sales and marketing space. The tool CloudLead that they're working on, it's basically he's working on his vision to create the ultimate tool to help sales and marketing people to utilize data to its fullest potential. And I'm super interested to learn much more about this. Welcome to the show, Norman.
Thank you, Lucas, for having me on the show. It's my pleasure to be on the show.
Very, very cool. So tell us all about CloudLead. What is it all about?
So CloudLead is basically a B2B data and lead generation company that combines technology with the human resource to bring in the most up-to-date and accurate data to the sales and marketing teams. How we do that is we've created our own bots that allow us to identify accounts based on ideal customer profiles for our customers. And then we have access to paid databases such as LinkedIn and other sources that allow us to identify prospects from those companies. And then we have a team of human resource that actually validate the information for accuracy, as well as to some extent, we also have human resource, a very specific telecommunication department that validates the information by phone.
Very
and
good.
And that makes us 99% accurate when it comes to B2B lead generation and data.
Got you. And how would be companies usually using? Is that a sort of a plug-in system into, you know, other tools like their CRMs, or how should we imagine the actual usage happening?
So the actual usage is more dependent on our website. It's not a plug-in, and right now we have not given the access to our tools to our customer. What they do is they simply generate a request with us on our website or by the email. We simply use our own softwares using our account management team and build the list and send it over or upload the list on the client's CRM system directly.
Gotcha. Okay. Makes total sense. Who would be the types of businesses? Because you mentioned, obviously, you know, sales might be very interested in potentially marketing as well. Who would be the types of people that are, or the types of businesses that are, you know, using CloudLead?
So basically, as of now, in my experience, the best of the customers that we have seen coming into us are from technology industry, software and technology industry, companies that have at least 3 to 4 people in their sales team and already have processes in place that, you know, where they require data for their outbound efforts. As well as inbound and lead enrichment, lead scoring, and all those kind of areas.
Gotcha. Yeah. Gotcha. Oh, okay. So it would be actually possible even to send you your inbound lead list and then get that enriched. Is that how I'm imagining this? Okay.
That's right. Yes. We can directly, we have, for one of our customers, what we do is they've given us access to their Salesforce account. And we have integrated that account with our software. And our team continuously validates the leads, scores the lead based on the customer profiles they have.
Very, very good. Very cool. Very interesting to learn about that. I would be curious now, since you're having these types of customers that you were just describing, how do people discover CloudLead? What are the sort of, you know, the user journey somebody's going through until they find out about CloudLead, or what would be the key channels really?
So basically, we use a blend of different tools, different sources to, you know, get found online. We use content marketing, we use email outreach, we use referral programs. We also have partnership in place with different, advertising companies in the U.S. that refer their customers to us. So we have a blend of different sources coming in for, you know, developing new business.
Very cool. And is there one that you're particularly excited about, which maybe you learned a lot about that is working really well?
Yes, Quora has been one of the best sources for us to identify new leads. It's actually a direct source for getting at least 5 to 8 new leads on a daily basis for us.
Gotcha. So that's answering on questions, I'm assuming?
Yes. Yes.
Very, very cool. Nice. I'm sure there's a lot of questions about identifying and finding leads on Quora. Very, very cool. Nice. Okay, so you mentioned people actually then coming to your website, I'm assuming as a next step from what you're doing there. We've been checking out the website a little bit. Can you tell me just a little bit about, you know, the role of the website? What purpose does the website play in your overall sort of path to, you know, finding clients?
So when people come onto our website, they have a request demo option. That's one of the options. Or simply they have access to identify the customer profiles on the website on the request a demo option. That gives us a little bit information on what the customer is actually looking forward to have. And we then schedule the call with the customer with a pre-made customized sample list of leads for them. Uh-huh. That allows them to evaluate what kind of service or product we're offering to them.
Very, very cool. Very interesting. And I saw that you have the demo there. Is that something that is really important? What have you learned? Because I'm asking that because we've talked to a lot of SaaS founders, you know, that play with sometimes having a trial, sometimes having a demo. Now you're bringing, you know, a pre-prepared list into the demo. What have you been learning about, you know, the right call to action on the page and the right way how to, you know, deal with the requests that are coming through?
So we don't have any right. See, there's no right or wrong when we talk about testing the website performance. We have tried multiple CTAs on our email campaigns, on our website, on different sources that redirect our prospects to our website. The best one that works for us is primarily is the Calendly link that we integrate with our website on our request demo options or any of the sources that we use to drive traffic. That directly allows our customer to open up the Calendly link and book a meeting with either me or any of the sales team members here at Cloudly. So that's been very effective for us.
Very cool. Very, very interesting, actually. I have to ask this question to you because, I mean, since you're obviously in the lead enrichment space, I'm really wondering how you guys are thinking about qualifying the leads that are coming to your website. Maybe some best practices that you can share. How would you be, you know, going about qualifying the leads that are coming to the page?
So we have a 5-minute rule for qualifying leads for our own self. So let's say when the lead comes in onto our CRM system, HubSpot, one of the senior account manager has access to all those leads. He qualifies the lead based on the criteria, number of salespeople in that company, their annual revenue, or funding they have raised in the recent past. That is maybe, let's say, in the last 12 or 15 months. Mm-hmm. What is their growth rate like, year over year growth or month over month, quarter over quarter growth? And then we identify who we are speaking to. If it's a junior sales executive or account executive that we're connecting with, then we have to come up with a different pitch. If we are speaking to a decision maker that is, you know, a sales VP of sales, we have to come up with a different pitch. So we score the leads accordingly for our own self.
Very, very interesting. Makes a lot of sense. I mean, you have the tool in house to get the lead enriched. So very, very cool. Is there anything, especially because you're so, you know, versatile in this particular area of qualification? You know, in the last interviews, I had a lot of different conversations. You know, one were around it was difficult to get people to show up to the demo. Another was about, you know, there's a too little amount of people are actually signing up for a demo. Different varying challenges around qualification depending on the size of the company. What would you say sort of is what you're thinking about that you want to improve in terms of qualification? Is there anything that you sort of have an eye on?
Our churn rate when it comes to lead subscribing for demos with us, I would say the churn rate that we have is high, and that's primarily because we have a lot of competition out there when it comes to lead and database vendors. We're trying to control that, and how we're trying to do that is we are trying to build a platform, integrating the platform with our platform that will connect our customer directly with our human resource team for communication, as well as getting data updated, enriched, and scored in real time by humans using our technology. So I think that would be a great step for us to control the churn rate and at least get the customers, get us started with a free or paid trial for the first 2 weeks or 3 weeks.
So that they can just get started by themselves?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying? Interesting. Yes. Interesting. Very, very cool. And we've, like I had said before, I had some couple of conversations around lead scoring. Some people are using HubSpot. for themselves. Are you using something different there, or are you leveraging sort of this standard?
We're using our own. We're eating our own dog's food right now.
Very, very cool. Nice. Very interesting. Cool. The other thing that is very interesting is usually when we speak in this type of conversations is about, you know, how many requests are SaaS companies able to generate from the website, right? And some people spend a lot of time, you know, A/B testing, really you're making sure that every call to action is set. What have you been learning when it comes to increasing the amount of, you know, demo requests, for example, in your case? Any war stories to share? Any things that you might want to improve?
The easiest way for us, to be honest, with increasing the amount of subscribers for demo request has been cold email outreach. Mm-hmm. We have a very specific customer profile that we go for. Mm-hmm. And typically, we do know our customers very well. That how do we know them? Is primarily we use reviews for our competitors on different websites. Let's say somebody has posted a negative review for XYZ company on G2 Crowd. Mm-hmm. And we know what the customer is, you know, actually having the problem with that kind of in that domain. We identify those leads and we simply send them a very customized email to get them to subscribe for a demo with us. Mm-hmm. So that's not really one of those things that we learned from that process was dissatisfied customers from other vendors had higher expectations. Mm-hmm. And we couldn't fulfill those situations in the past that we're working on right now. So that was a great learning experience for us from that point of view.
Very, very cool. So like sort of you're optimizing your email outreach and then the experience on the website. Anything else on the website that you were looking to improve? I don't know, maybe, you know, the typical things we speak here about is like bounce rates or maybe that the traffic is not leading to enough demos. Anything that you are having an eye on?
We're doing multiple things on the website side to decrease the bounce rate. We're trying to run more customized ads on LinkedIn, mm-hmm. Quora, mm-hmm. And as well as on Google AdWords to identify why we have currently somewhere close to 30% to 40% bounce rate on our website, and we're trying to decrease that by targeting the right set of companies on different social media sources.
Very cool. Anything that you've learned in that process, maybe that you can share, what has helped you to improve your performance there?
We've tried multiple content strategies. Head of marketing with us, Maz Nagori, has been working very closely with the content team to tweak the content and see what's working and what's not working. And we're really typically, for now, we're going for the very specific keywords that redirect the right traffic to us. I cannot exactly pinpoint the right strategies because that's the head of marketing.
Yep.
Who's been handling this.
Makes a lot of sense. Makes a lot of sense. Really, really cool. Nice. Thanks a lot for sharing. This is super interesting to get really into the weeds here and understand what, you know, a busy SaaS founder is thinking about. Really, really cool. Okay, so maybe let's switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about you as a founder, right? About you as a person and how you've been building up the company. Maybe you can tell me first, like, how would you be describing your own goal? Like, what is maybe your next KPI that you personally want to hit? Like, how do you set your own goals and what do the goals look like?
So I'm very keen. So let's go back and see where. Let me explain how this all started with me as a personal experience. Back in 2006, when I started my career in this industry, I was working for a company called Clinical Advisors from New York, mm-hmm. and I was their junior research and account executive for identifying prospects for their stores to sign up for the paid consortium they were organizing. Mm-hmm. And I had access to multiple tools like, you know, DNB, ZoomInfo, Hoovers, and other sources. And I realized the data that we were trying to pull out had almost 50% bounce ratio on email, and mm-hmm. phone numbers were a hit or a miss.
Yep.
And that's where I built up a team for my own, a team in-house for the company, led a team of 5 to 8 researchers and 3 account executives to validate, constantly find new prospects and validate the information to make sure that my account executives, senior account executives in New York are not wasting time in reaching out the decision maker.
Yep.
So that's how it all started. And then in 2012, I started the first company called eList Guy, which more sounds like a one-man show company, which is why I had to rebrand the entire company in 2016 under the name of CloudLead.
Yep.
And we initially got customers like Foundry, which got acquired by another company. Mm-hmm. We had customers like Import.io, mm-hmm. Oracle, Insight Square, who we helped identify prospects from different sources. So that's how it all started. Personally, when you ask me where I see myself in the next 5 years, that would be leading a data company that's helping every salesperson effectively get the most accurate data with the most accurate direct dials and the email addresses.
Very cool. Yeah, I'm very curious. And what type of specific goal would you set yourself? Because I'm very interested, always, to hear from the CEO themselves. Like, what is maybe something concrete that they say, okay, this quarter or this year or this month? Like, how do you set your goals? And what would be one, maybe, or two typical goals that you set yourself?
So the goals that we have set for in terms of sales, there are 3 types of goals that we've set for our company. One, we got accepted by an incubator, accelerator in Canada. Mm-hmm. Under the startup visa program that allows us to relocate to Canada and move the operations and front office from US to Canada, mm-hmm. while the back office remains in Karachi, Pakistan.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the goals, that we have to move there and jumpstart our operations from Canada. The second goal, when it comes to marketing, we want to up our marketing budget and bring more traffic on the website.
Mm-hmm.
That is directly going to reflect on our sales. The third goal, which is the biggest goal that we have set for this year, is for the next 2 quarters, I would say, is move to Canada, build a sales team there, and jumpstart or grow our sales by at least 30%, which is very much doable.
Yep.
And that's going to help us bootstrap to the next level.
Very, very cool. Very, very exciting times there with the switch into Canada and, like, you know, leveling up the operations. Very cool. And you personally, as a founder, how do you educate yourself further? Like, where do you read? Where do you, what, who do you listen to? Maybe you can give us an idea. How do you educate yourself?
I listen to multiple influencers, but currently I'm following one person who's very interesting. It's Edward de Bono. Okay. He wrote the famous book, Think, Teach Yourself How to Think.
Mm-hmm.
And lateral thinking. He's actually, it's actually learning from him about how to be a part of critical thinker,
yeah,
and how to maximize on effectively using your brain to think in the right direction, focus on the right goals.
Very, very interesting. And what's your experience? Does it work for you?
It's working, looks like, yes.
Very good. Very, very cool. And what would be another topic that you recently have been researching? You mentioned, the teaching yourself the critical thinking or making that even more sharper. Any other topics that you have recently researched yourself?
To be honest, yes, but that's more related to anxiety and stress management. As a founder, I've got a lot of things to manage. And yeah. I think anxiety is a very understated or, underspoken topic that most people shy from. So I've been researching on those topics and trying to educate my team here in Pakistan on how to cope up with stress.
Wow, I think that's really, really good. And I really appreciate you bringing that up, because you could have mentioned, so many other sort of, KPI related stuff. But I think this is really cool that you're bringing that up. Maybe just a one last question to wrap mm-hmm. up the interview. The question would be, if you would be able to sort of go back in time and start your company from scratch again, what would be one advice that you would give yourself?
The only advice I would give myself is, don't look back, travel, meet more people from the industry, attend more conferences, and mm-hmm. be in the constant cycle of building relationships. Mm-hmm. Because what I've experienced is, finding a new customer is easy, but managing the relationship is difficult, and that requires more traveling, meeting you know, with the client face to face.
And how do you do this personally as a founder to balance the, you know, the time that you spend on those events versus, you know, being sort of heads down or with the team strategically or operationally on the work? Like, how do you make the sort of trade-off calls there?
So that's one of the most difficult parts of my life. I literally spend 1 month in Karachi. Mm-hmm. And then the next moment I'm on the plane. I literally don't know next day, next week, where am I going to be. I have to be in Dubai next week. Then I have to be in San Francisco. And then I'm also due in Calgary. Mm-hmm. So that part is, my calendar is pretty much booked throughout the year.
Wow.
So that's very difficult to manage for me at this point, to be honest. With kids, let me say.
Wow. That is, I mean, respect that you're basically pulling all of this off. Really, really cool to learn. Really, really great to see sort of the inside, what is really going behind the scenes, what the product is all about, how you're thinking about growth, how you're thinking about important topics that are even, you know, very important to your employees as well, like stress management and anxiety, and then which type of challenges you face as a founder as well. So thanks for being part of the episode and sharing a little bit about sort of your background and your company.
Thank you, Lucas. It was great being on the show.